We're here with Professor Joao Carlos Espada, a professor at the Institute of Political Studies at the Catholic University of Portugal. So Joao, if you could please describe what led you to found the Institute and some of your work there.
Okay, well, first of all, thank you very much for inviting me. So I founded this Institute about 20 years ago, 1996. So the main point of this Institute, which has grown since then, initially was a small MA program in political science and political theory. Now is a full, we have BA and MA, PhD program, political science, international relations, security and defense, European studies. So it has grown over the years. But the main idea, I think, at the time was to create a program in political science that could be different and free from the radicalism of politically correctness that was already at that time, and perhaps today even more, sort of dominating the state universities in Portugal. So we created this program, which it's independent, it's free from this control political correct uniform, dogmatic uniformity. If you ask me what was the main distinctive feature, well, it's difficult to say one or two.
Main distinctive features, but perhaps I would say we are committed to study the Western tradition of liberty and personal responsibility. So we are proud of our Western civilization, whereas most of our colleagues at state universities, I'm not saying all, of course, but most, have this very peculiar sort of self-hatred against our free societies. And this is very puzzling for me, because I studied in Britain under the supervision of Karl Popper and Ralph Dahrendorf. Popper was Austrian, Dahrendorf was German. They both went into, actually Dahrendorf was arrested in Germany by the Nazis. Popper went into exile into New Zealand before the Anschluss, the annexation of Austria by the Nazis in 1938. Then he came back to London. Dahrendorf was a student of Popper at the LSE, etc., etc. Well, but my point, to cut a long story short, my point is I studied with these two scholars who, they were proud of the West because they had fought for the West, because the West was at risk during the Second World War, threatened by Nazism, threatened by communism. So, they were proud of liberty and personal responsibility. Now, why is it that among our universities, most of our colleagues have this self-hatred of the West? It's very strange. Certainly, we don't have that at my institute in Lisbon. And we are committed to the study of this very old tradition that has evolved, that has several voices, that speaks at several voices. There is no single voice representing the West. The West is precisely, it has been a long conversation between different voices, different points of view, and that's what we do.
Now, I know beyond your work in the academy, you've also been involved in the practical politics of Poland and beyond. Would you mind describing some of that?
Oh, of Poland. Oh, yes. This was, this was long ago in the 90s, actually during the Solidarnosc period, the movement Solidarity, the trade union that led by Lech Walesa, that started the fight against the communist regime in Poland in the 1980s. I was in Lisbon. I'd never been to Poland until a couple of years ago, so I had no personal connection with Poland. I created a small movement in Portugal called Solidarity with Solidarity. So Solidarity with Solidarnosc, which was the name of the Polish trade union. And we created a small, Samizdat, that was the name. In the communist countries, the clandestine, the
you know, papers were called Samizdat, and they circulate underground and all that. So we created this Samizdat, this sort of bulletin, you know, but very, how can I say, it was not a professional newspaper or anything. It was something that you could do almost at home or something like that. And we circulated it. It was called Solidarity with Solidarnosc. And and then we organized meetings in support of the Polish freedom fighters. So what happened was that much later, I mean, I don't know, 10 years ago or even, no, less than 10 years ago, I received a phone call from the Polish ambassador in Lisbon, Katarzyna Skorzyńska, saying that they wanted to, award me a this benemerito distinction, and also even before the merit, I received now three recognitions from Poland. The initial one was from Gdansk, the Solidarity Center. So Solidarity, Solidarnosc. So they were. Gdansk was the basis of the initial trade union movement in 1980s. So they gave me this award, Medal of Gratitude, a very touching name. Yeah. And and then later I received the Benemerito distinction from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And last year, I think it was, I received another distinction from the President. I mean, but this is all because in the 1980s I was, I was no longer a student, but I was sort of at university an assistant professor, and I just did this with my friend and all that. So that's all. In 2011, 12, and 13, I was the chairholder of the European Parliament. Bronislav Geremek, European Civilization Chair, that's a long title, at the College of Europe in Warsaw for 3 years. And this was a chair as a tribute to the Bronislav Geremek, who had been in the resistance against communism, then became Minister of after the transition to democracy, became Minister of Foreign Affairs of Poland. And they created this chair, and I applied, and so I held this chair for 3 years. But that's all. I mean, so I had no particular connection with Poland beyond this.
Surely one of the most well-known voices of Western civilization, at least in the 20th century, is Winston Churchill.
Yeah.
You're a fan?
Yeah, absolutely.
So, why are you a fan, and what do you see as Churchill's bigger role in the conversation around Western civilization this last century?
Well, this could lead us to a very long conversation. But I can tell you how I started. I mean, I was educated when I was a child in an atmosphere that was in my country, in Portugal. My parents were pro-British, especially pro-American, actually. But the main thing that that started all this thing about Churchill was when I first visited Karl Popper in England in his house near London. This was 1987 or 88. I was we were talking, and he has a very nice sitting room with lots of books, a sort of small library. I was looking at the books, and I could see that the books were all very well chosen. So he was not a book collector, the sort of chap that buys books by the pleasure of having books. He had a very selected collection of authors and books and all. And at a certain moment, I saw a huge collection of books by Churchill and about Churchill. But I mean, you can't imagine, it was really huge. And I said, "Well, Sir Carl, I'm sorry, but why do you have so many books about Churchill?" I was much younger at that time. So, and I said, "Wasn't he mainly a politician, or no? Wasn't he basically a politician?" And he looked at me, "What?" He says, "Sit down, my boy. I have to teach you something." And then he gave me a lecture about Churchill and how Churchill had saved Western civilization, and he spoke for, I don't know, the recollection I have is that he spoke for 1 hour or something about Churchill and the English-speaking peoples and the fight, the struggle for freedom and this, this and that. So I was tremendously impressed. And since then, so this was 87, 88, maybe 88. So I started paying more attention to Churchill and buying books and reading and this and that. Dahrendorf, then I went to study with Dahrendorf. Dahrendorf was also a great admirer of Churchill.
But Popper was really,
you know, over the top. So Churchill for Popper was the top of the top. Anyway, so this led me to read and study about Churchill, and then I came to realize that there was something called the International Churchill Society, which I didn't know about. And then we decided to create a small chapter, section of the International Churchill Society in Portugal, and this was back in 2002 or 2003. So we are still there, very active. And we now at the Institute, we have two annual lectures at the Institute for Political Studies. One is the Alexis de Tocqueville annual lecture, which is usually in February, where we award diplomas and degrees to the students. And now there is another one, which is the Winston Churchill opening lecture, which is in September, October, and opens the academic year. And we have a Winston Churchill room at the Institute, meeting room, with Winston Churchill, Magna Carta, and then on the left, on the right of Churchill, on the left, if you look at it, it's the treaty, the Windsor Treaty. That's the treaty between England and Portugal, which was signed in 1386. So that's the story, catalogue story short. Now, why was Churchill so decisive? Well, I can't in a brief, basically because he was the only one that, during the 1930s, he was completely isolated in his own Conservative Party. He was a member of the Conservative Party, even though he had been, in 1904, Churchill moved from the Conservatives to the Liberals. In 1924, he went back to the Conservatives. So in the early 1920s, in the early 1930s, he was already again a conservative. But he was in opposition to the politics of appeasement of his own government, conservative government. And he was also against the pacifism of the Labour Party. So Popper actually says that Churchill was, during the 1930s, probably the only political leader, significant political leader, that perceived the threat of Hitler and Nazism and was denouncing it courageously and saying we must face this threat. And in fact, more or less what he predicted, what Churchill predicted that was going to happen, in fact happened, because the Western, the liberal democracies, Britain, France mainly, did not stand up against Nazis. And then, as you know, in 1st September 1939, Poland was invaded by Hitler. In the 17th of September, Poland was invaded by Stalin. So in fact, we had the two totalitarian powers, Nazi Germany and Communist Russia, getting together to, attack liberal democracy, Western liberal democracies. And Churchill was there.
So we've talked a bit about the past, and to close, I'd really like to ask you about the future. A common thread in many of the things that you've said so far is the notion of the open society and defending it and its past and history and your role in preserving it now. What do you see as the future of the open society?
Well, I don't know, but I'm glad that you mentioned the open society. Yeah, I think Karl Popper's book, The Open Society and Its Enemies, published in 1945, he presented it as his war effort in defense of liberal democracy against the totalitarianism, both communist and Nazi totalitarianism. So what is, I don't know, but I mean, what I think is in the future, or I mean in the present and the future, as like in the past, the main point about the open society is that we defend it, defend the open society, because precisely because of it, of its openness, the open society, unlike closed societies, which are based on dictatorship and oppression and persecution of dissident voices or different voices, in the open society, the distinctive feature is precisely freedom, liberty, and personal responsibility too. So if we lose the perception of the, how can I say, the difference of the open society, if we lose the perception of the conflict, the clash between open and closed societies, if we start saying every point of view is equal to its opposite, so it doesn't really matter whether the society is open or it's not open, that depends on cultures, that depends on this and on that. If we start thinking like that, if we lose our, how can I say, I mean, it's especially a question of understanding, I think. So understanding the distinctiveness of a free society. If we lose that understanding, then we'll be defeated because our enemies actually know the difference and they hate us, not because of what we do, but because of what we are. Not because of our societies do, and of course our society, we make mistakes, everyone makes mistakes, so we also make mistakes, but that's not the question, and we are open to discussion about mistakes, but the question is our enemies hate us not because of this or that, this or that possible mistake that we have made, but because of what we are, and that is the main threat they feel, because we are free. So I think the important point is to continue the study and conversation about this Western tradition of liberty and personal responsibility. And by the way, I'm very glad to be here because the Antigua Forum has this commitment to liberty, and especially I'm very glad that I came to Universidad Francisco Marroquín for the first time, and I've been teaching this week, and I'll be still teaching on Monday, I think, and Tuesday, and has been a great experience. The students are very good, engaging, and especially that there is a spirit of liberty, and I mean a commitment to liberty and personal responsibility, which I find so important and also so agreeable and rewarding. Because the situation very strange is that in most of our state universities nowadays, in Europe, and I'm not sure about Latin America, but I suppose it won't be very different, but certainly in Europe, it's incredible what, how can I say, the dominance of these ideas of politically correct, the self-hatred against the West, it's so strange, really. But it's growing, and there is this sort of dogmatic uniformity that the West is to blame for anything that may happen, or have happened, or will happen. Anyway, so I'm very glad that I am in a university committed to the values of liberty and personal responsibility.
Thank you very much, Raul.
Okay, thank you. I thank you.